And on that, we cue the music.
It's Sunday, TGIS. Thanks everybody for being here. Tonight, we're just going to have a discussion. Fellowship of the Dolly style. We're going to be discussing playsets. Playsets we love, playsets we didn't really care for. What makes a playset great? What does a playset need? Where did the playsets go? That's what we're going to be talking about tonight. So, Mo was first. Good to see you, Mo. G.I. Marco is reporting for duty. Curse of Fenrir, Nikotronis, James Lucas, Mython the Python, Robert's Infinite Realms, Uri, buddy in the house. Thank you all for being here. George Aiken, all the way from the other side of the world. My scheduled guest is this guy.
Well, hello there.
Hello, Mr. Vargo. How are you?
Just chilling.
It's good to see you again.
Yep.
I just saw you the other day.
I know. It's like twice in 1 month, but what's going on?
I know, it's fancy. Fancy stuff. Nice shirt. I like that shirt.
Thanks. Good shirt. It's not technically authorized, but hey, custom ink will print anything.
Yeah. You know, I have to apologize to you and everybody hanging out with us tonight because I had to bring my grandfather with me today. Yeah. So I had to bring my grandfather and
oh,
hi grandpa.
My boy,
how are you?
So handsome.
Can you hear me?
Oh, look at your soul patch.
Can you hear me?
Oh, what? Butterscotch.
Did you say Matlock?
Matlock.
What's up, Mikey?
Good evening.
How are you?
Doing well. How are you, gentlemen?
Good.
Little delay on that. I'm having trouble believing the authenticity of that answer, but okay.
All right, let's try it again. Do it again. We'll just edit that out. Go.
How are you, gentlemen, this evening?
Oh, I'm just doing chill. Great. Fantastic.
Great.
Fantastic. Speaking of fantastic and fantastic people.
Yeah.
We got two more people that are going to hang out with us tonight. Rad people. Had them on before. All the way from Dancing for Dollies. It's Vache and Samantha.
Oh, it's
what are you guys up to?
Oh man, just hanging out. We had some tea earlier, just got to relax a little bit. We're supposed to go see Ghostbusters. My boss is gonna pay for it. I was like, free movie, don't care what it looks like, but as it would happen, didn't happen. So
you know, I've heard both. I've heard people say it's great. I've heard people say it's not. But again, that's why I don't care what other people's opinions are about anything, because I love Megaforce. And a lot of people say Megaforce is crap, and I think they should be burned at the stake. Anyway, that's about it. Oh, Bardo's here all the way from Canada. Right. What's up, Bardo? Gotta get tough.
Hey.
Yojo. Yep. We're going to get tough. We're going to get tough on some playsets here in a minute. I didn't really think about it, but we were kind of all chit-chatting backstage. All of us are going to DFW.
Yep.
Yes.
It's going to be a wonderful show.
Vargo, what are you, anything you're really looking forward to with the DFW?
Not really. We're just kind of going to see what's there. The 3¾-inch world is open back up to me. So,
I see you're filling those shelves with all your sweet core scores. Yep. Core scores.
Yeah, that works.
Core score. Yeah. Okay. Yeah. I said, God help me. Just wait. I'm telling you, it's going to be nothing
but
buying everything and photobombing. It's coming. Trust me, it's coming. Mikey knows. He knows what's up.
Yeah, it's going to be fun.
It's accurate. Yeah.
Vishay, Samantha, anything that you guys are looking forward to?
Getting a chance to meet the people that, you know, were not necessarily from my childhood, but after all, because my older brother was, it was his childhood in the 80s. But just being able to meet all of them, I'd love to get a Joe book signed from my older brother and just hanging out with everyone. You know, like Joe Fest was really, really fun. That was my first convention for sure. And Samantha's as well. So that was a wonderful experience. So to now go to another convention in a different state, a different city, and just hang out with more people. That's to me the best part. So I'll be traveling a lot during the summer anyway. So that'll be a good break from having to put on expensive dance clothes and sweat in front of a bunch
lots of sequins. Yeah.
Yeah. Not as many sequins. Sam has actually most of the sequins. Her dress is the best, but
lots of rhinestones.
Maybe a button or two down. We normally go two down.
Vaseline? Probably a bad question. Our good friend Suka, what's up, brother, says, I heard V is doing a chips and salsa panel.
I am, yes.
Flash class.
Picante, salsa verde, whichever one you want, Suka. Just for you. Just for Suka.
I like the green. I like the green. Jeff Butler said, looking forward to meeting you all in person at DFW. Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, Jeff,
it's going to be great. It's super fun.
I'm going to star this. We're going to come back around to George. I got cat hair in my face now. We're going to come back around to George Aiken's comment right here in a little bit. Masterson 42, speaking of super awesome guys that always get a crisp salute from me, I look forward to meeting all of you again at DFW. Yep. It'll be good to see you again. Yep. Severus Snape, pardon me, says, saw a booth at a con today that was all custom-made diorama bases for Joe's. It was quite impressive and sold out quickly.
That's awesome.
That's rad.
Not surprising it sold out quick.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. No. Mikey, what about you? You got your own booth going on, yeah?
I do.
Right, trying to make sure I don't roll over my cat.
Don't do that. Okay. Yeah, first time having a booth or a table, I guess, technically.
Yeah.
Actually. Yeah, I'm super looking forward to it. Should be able to be close to Longbow so I can help Dad with that. So very much looking
help forward. Help or call on him? Dad. Dad.
I got a feeling that's going to be the other way around. Dad.
Help me, Dad. there's five of us here. What do you guys say? Do you want to secret word it? Should we secret word it today?
Yeah.
Sure.
Probably better.
Remember, you can't say it, right?
They
I'm the one that always fails at this. You can't get suckered, right? So I think we got enough people in the chat already. Andrew M says, what the hell's a playset?
Dirt patch and some rocks.
Yeah, right? Man, I remember playing with stompers and digging tunnels and launching them down through and letting them, you know, go.
Oh, yeah. The clothesline outside was a great playset.
Yeah.
Yes. Okay, so here we go. We're gonna do it.
Do it.
Go.
Today's word is
3, 2, 1.
That one
might get a lot of traction and it might not. You know, a lot of the features on playsets are very
functional,
playable,
fun.
Yeah. Matt Noon says Sandbox is a great playset. Yeah, absolutely.
My favorite growing up. Yep.
Secret word time. Yeah, we did it. Oh, look, Marco's already trying. I see it. Not going to say it. Shane Brayless says, can you use it in a sentence, please? Yeah, I suppose we could. Mikey, why don't you give a demonstration? Use it in a sentence, please.
See, the fireable missiles on a command playset make it very toyetic.
That was painful.
Yeah!
And that's it.
Not a word I use in my day-to-day life.
Oh, we got it. Jeremy Kerr says, my Sarlacc pit playset was a hole in the ground with toothpicks for teeth.
That's brilliant. Like it.
Now you can get one of those Dune popcorn tubs.
That Dune popcorn.
The ground. Why not, right?
And you throw your new one, though. Don't buy that off of somebody, okay?
Yeah.
Ew. Yeah. It's an ew. Do you see Suka's comment? I'm going to put it up, but I'm not going to read it.
That's a good one.
We need that freaking. What is that? Nickelodeon? I think that's.
Is that what that's from?
I think so.
I can't remember what part of Nickelodeon. Yeah.
I don't know. Yeah. Yeah, that's accurate. Viper Scout says, my couch was Cobra Mountain. You know, when I was a kid, my grandmother, she had all those decorative ashtrays.
Mm hmm.
You know what I'm talking about, where they like blown glass and metal and they're all funky looking. I remember she had this specific one that was kind of maroonish, brownish, and it was almost shaped like a spade. And I would put all my Star Wars figures in it, and it was my land speeder for the longest time. Every time I'd go, and nobody ever used the ashtrays. They were just decorative. So I would just with them and a white sheet or a blanket makes a great snow scene.
Yeah.
Why not?
I used to take the cheese pizza, the little table that goes on
there.
Table,
yeah.
Use that as a command center, wash it off, set it, do a couple of those. Yeah.
That's awesome.
Definitely.
Viper Scout says, some people's flag was a coffee table. My coffee table was the flag. I mean, a flag is pretty much a coffee table, right? It's kind of like a dining room table, but yeah, absolutely. Lou's here. What's up, Lou? Good to see you. And Geek Speak Hub says, my brothers in Christ, howdy. Good to see you. Soul Brother number one says, Shoebox served as X-Wing and TIE Fighter stand-ins.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, absolutely. Just Jeff. Evening. Hope all are well. Good to see you, Jeff. Why do some playsets have more features? Oh, man. Did I not proofread this? Damn it, but I didn't get there. Do I have to finish reading it?
No.
Yeah, I mean, you caught it. You can sub in a word.
No. He kind of caught me. He kind of caught me. Why do some playsets have more features than another? The real Ghostbusters had doors and a pole, like some other places we know. That being said, the car didn't fit inside the playset.
It didn't.
That's
right. I mean, like a third of that thing hung out. So, good playset. It did have some really good features, play features. Bionic 6 had a point million. Why was one more toyetic than another?
Yeah!
Okay, that's all you get. I don't know. That's a good question. Logic Blaster says, when I was a kid, I built play sets for my action figures and Hot Wheels cars out of Legos.
100%.
Yep.
Yes.
You know, it's funny because we were just talking about Lego because we were discussing the G.I. Joe Built to Rule playset, which is a playset.
Yes.
It is a playset. And then we were all kind of saying, why don't they just get together with Lego and do some kind of a thing where, you know? But Legos make great anything because you can build it to suit your needs, but also put a bunch of Legos together, paint it gray, put some wash on it. You got a nice brick wall. Fantastic diorama. Masterson 42, thank you for the $5 super chat, sir. Here's another salute. My question to later ponder: what makes something a playset? What makes it a vehicle, and can they be both? Well, we can hash that out right now.
Yeah,
definitely they can be both.
Because one of the Joe, you know, because I'm mostly Joe-centric, right? Spoiler alert: I'm sure nobody's surprised by that. The last mass retail playset that G.I. Joe put out wasn't even a playset at all. Really, it was both as a playset and a vehicle, right?
Mm.
Yep.
So 2008 Rise of Cobra, which is the mobile headquarters pit or pit mobile headquarters, whatever you want to call it. This was the last mass retail large vehicle slash playset that they put out. Kind of in the vein of the Mobile Command Center or MCC, the way that it kind of opened. It's a little tackle box style as well. But yeah, this is the last one they put out. But yeah, I would definitely say this is both. It rolls and it also opens up. It has the verticality, right? That's something that we were all kind of talking about. It has play features. Anybody want to touch on this?
So I vividly remember my younger brother wanting this. This was kind of the phase I had. Left for college, I come back for a couple of months, and we're trying to, he really wanted something along those lines, but he didn't have the room for it. So I was like, well, we can just make another playset like that. I think we did use like a shoebox or something. And he still had a couple of Legos. So I was like, yeah, we just put some of that stuff together. I do see it as both. I mean, for me, a vehicle can be a playset because a lot of, especially if you have like an action scene or a fight scene, normally happens on a vehicle. So because if you're moving or they're having, you know, having a quick mission update or something like that. Someone in the comments even said, you know, there's a lot of carrying vehicles that carrying cases that were handled. So it was like a mobile command center that you can open up. So yeah, I think they could be both.
Yeah, the APC is definitely a carrying case.
Yeah.
100% a carrying case. But just like this and what you were saying, Vishay, vehicles that are playsets also involve locations. So the Millennium Falcon is a perfect example of that because you have the hollow chest area, you have the training little spot, like those are locations from the film. Yes, they're within a vehicle, but it also becomes a playset at the same time. You got that little compartment for smuggling.
Yeah.
Flag. What's the flag? Both playset? What is it?
Yeah.
Both. Yeah.
I would say the determining factor for me is if a vehicle has, call them operating positions outside of passenger or gunner, then it is also a playset. So like G.I. Joe APC, vehicle. Action Force APC, vehicle, playset.
Yeah, because the ATC does have a command center and it's got the little med bay in it and all that stuff. Yeah.
But does the flag have mobility?
Depends. No, a standard flag does not have any type of mobility to it. No. That's a good point. I don't know. I mean, it is classified as a playset.
It's based on a real life vehicle, you know, like
true. Yeah.
You know, but yeah, I think it would be hard. I would look at a playset as something that you could gather around and literally in a set position versus your vehicles being able to move and you can travel and then you can, you know, keep it somewhere and then nomadic almost.
Yeah. Gizambrano, what's up? Says, I miss my Terradrome. Friends had the OG headquarters. Cousin had the battle platform. Vaguely remembers somebody with the flag. Very cool. And then Andrew M says the pole is the true hero in the new Ghostbusters movie. haven't seen it yet.
Yeah.
Yeah. And then David Andrews does have a point that is one of the failings of Boulder Hill is that the Rhino, like the mask signature vehicle does not fit through the doors.
Yeah.
True. Yeah. Yeah. Mikey, read that.
That's what she said. A third of that thing hung out.
Hey, James, she couldn't say it because her mouth was full.
Oh, man. George Aiken says the Palitoy Action Force headquarters had a few plastic parts, but it had a chute and deployable airfield opening cardboard doors. Damn it. It was very toyetic.
They're not even super chats, Chad. They're getting you on non-super chats.
Yeah, but I read every
has it down to like an art form. Like Chad's almost guaranteed to read his comment. And if he's not proofreading, gotcha.
As long as they put the word
gotcha, bitch.
Gotcha, bitch.
They all know that if they put something like really cool at the beginning, they know I'm gonna read it. They know I'm gonna. Yeah. Right?
It's all about the tip of the comment. Just the tip.
Balake is here. Dan Jamin. D-Nice, Balake. I'd argue the Mobile Command Center and Defiant are vehicles and playsets. Absolutely. Yeah. What about this one, though? I think Rolling Thunder is a playset.
I would not agree.
You would what?
I would not agree with that.
I mean, I think if you have it set up with the missiles out, and you know, I think you can set it up to be a playset. I think, unless you fully open everything up, but that's the same with the MCC. You know, if you open everything up, you could get figures down where the rockets lay flat, and you could kind of have.
You can put vamp down there. The tires go right in those missile slots, almost like wheel wells. I think it's cool that we all have our own idea of what is a playset, what is a vehicle, what is both, right? Nikotronis says the whale is kind of both. Thoughts?
I mean,
I would probably put the whale more as just a vehicle.
I personally agree. Yeah. I would say closer would be the general, closer to being a playset and a vehicle.
And yeah.
Probably just because you have a big flat surface on top and you could definitely do stuff on top, but they're still passengers and gunner seats. So my qualifications are still vehicles.
I'm going to spend the whole show like staring at my vehicles. Like, I don't know.
I mean, the general's got all that space underneath the big green pads too. I would say.
Well, and it also has like pass through doors between all the three sections.
That's true.
I'm going to say, this is just me personally, right? Take it or leave it. We all have our own opinions. Flag is a playset. Whale is a vehicle. Defiant is both. MCC is both. General is a vehicle. Rolling Thunder is a vehicle. And even the freaking Thunderclap is just a vehicle. Just me. It's just me. I'm going to take this thing off the screen. But before I do, so this was the last major retail vehicle / playset. We'll just call it playset, right? For the argument's sake of the show title. This was the last playset they put out. Mass retail. However, pause for dramatic effect. In 2017, San Diego Comic-Con was this exclusive right here.
That's I heard a guy who hates G.I. Joe put this out.
A guy who does hate G.I. Joe made this. Vachet, do you know who that guy was?
No. Who is that guy?
You really don't know?
Come no, on.
You know. Who was that? Bobby.
Oh.
Yeah.
That's hilarious.
Uh-huh. Yeah, so it was just, it was a faithful reproduction with modern figures of the original Sears exclusive cardboard playset from 80.
That's right. I didn't know that, but I'd forgotten that, like, that was one of the main things that he wanted to put out was
something
to pay homage for that.
So this is the last playset, even though it wasn't exclusive, and I'm not the biggest fan of the exclusivity of certain things unless they're repaints. This was it. It was the very last thing that G.I. Joe put out. But what are some other playsets that we have seen in retail since then, since 2017?
Well, Motu puts out a big one, almost a big one every year at this point.
What'd you say?
Motu puts out a big one almost every year at this point.
Yeah. So Mattel and Masters of the Universe are the biggest, I don't want to say red flag, but, you know, obvious thing when people say, well, we can't do playsets anymore. Playsets don't sell.
What is it? The Playfix, the kids line, they put like a Batmobile Command Center. They put out like they actually put the Power Rangers Megazord out, you know.
Sure did.
They've done that quite a bit.
The core
Play does some good stuff.
Why did it have interior rock walls? What had interior rock walls?
I think the pit headquarters.
Really?
I
think it did.
Training purposes?
I think so. Something like that.
Yeah. It's one of the things I don't have.
I can't think of anyone that's like other than those that we talked about put out active playsets in retail, which even made me think about, you know, even growing up as a kid, McDonald's and Burger King would have, you know, Happy Meals that would, your, you know, Happy Meal box would be a playset because they would do different whatever themes. It's like, oh, hey, you can put your car through here or you can stack your balloons up here. They don't even do those anymore. So even from like a food standpoint, we don't do a whole lot of.
Speak of the devil.
Oh. I had no idea. I really didn't.
Hold that thought 1 second. And then Mr. Vargo, I want you to talk about this thing.
Okay.
I know. I hope you're joking about the verticality, because that's a legit word. And I don't know if you just tried to irritate me so I would say toyetic and then play the fucking scream. I'm going to do it anyway, but verticality is damn well a word. It's a word. Yeah. Yeah. Mr. Vargo.
Yeah.
Why don't you talk to us about this playset that you just sent me?
Yeah. So I have no idea how or when I got this. I just remember at some point they're like, here you go. Here is a McDonald's playset that's basically fits 3¾-inch figures. And I was like, this is awesome. I love McDonald's. I can use my G.I. Joes here as a base of operations for, you know, they set up, you know, covertly in the McDonald's. And, you know, it was just, I think it came out in 2003. So it just was one of those wacky, fun play sets that, you know, I had growing up.
I like that manager lady with her arms like this. She's like, welcome to McDonald's. Can I help you?
Yeah, she used to work at Popeyes. She's ready to roll.
Go.
And that little grimace chair up on the top was on a spring, so you could like sit a figure, pull it back, and it just launches up.
That's awesome.
So the grimace chair was the interrogation chair.
It's still fun, and at the end of the day, it is a playset. I mean, look at down in the lower corner, it opens up. That's pretty awesome.
And it has a carry handle.
Yep.
What?
Yeah.
What?
I need to pick that up again.
Absolutely. Is it mobile?
Yeah, is it like a flag situation here where you know the actual thing is mobile, but the toy isn't?
Yeah, I think that's this one sail barge that I've seen, that it's once you've set that thing up, it's going to sit where it sits. You better have it how you want it, so.
You know, the one time that I saw a Kitana out of the box, I never thought to look at the underside of it. You know, you're just looking at it, and I'm looking at all the detail inside of it, and I'm like, oh, that's really cool. But I was never like, oh, let me look under your skirt, baby. You know, like, it never crossed my mind. So I don't know.
Well, I mean, I feel like we got to a point where we had a lot of vehicles that were immobile because they wanted to make it kind of like an actual playset, you know, to reenact scenes. But then you had a lot of playsets that were mobile because you could travel and move them around as well. Because there were some, it's like, hey, here's a very, you know, shortened scale version of this bass, but you can travel and move it everywhere. And then you had, okay, you know, the Gitana. All right, here's a vehicle, but we're going to make it like an actual platform. Yeah. And then it became a bass that people just used.
So you're giving mobile more than one definition.
Well, if you also look at, is it... can you store it? Like, do you store your figures in it, right? There are a lot of play sets that's like, okay, you can literally store them in, you know, their command center base or the jail, but then you have a lot of vehicles that had, okay, here's the gunner position, but I just have to set it here.
Yeah, the 83 headquarters, you could store weapons and file cards and all sorts of stuff in there. Yeah, it did have storage capacity. It's true. J-Mac reminds everyone to get your Vanguard pre-orders in before the 31st. You know, helping a brother out.
Tell me what to do.
Tell me what to do. But, you know, that being said, that is a good public service announcement. I know a lot of us look back on, you know, playsets that, you know, we purchased or we had in our childhood or, you know, we got our hands on as adult collectors. And we kind of look at the whole thing with playsets as through rose-tinted glasses, but do any of you guys remember the Empire Strikes Back Star Destroyer playset?
I've seen it. I've never had one, but...
Did you see how shitty it was?
Yeah, just the triangle, basically.
Yeah. Yeah. Mikey, can you pull that up? While you're sitting there doing your thing? Yeah.
I can. Oh.
So that's kind of another one of those things where... We did get a lot of great play sets. And, you know, I've got the Conquest of Cobra Mountain box right here just to, you know, whatever, since we're discussing play sets. But not every play set was a home run, especially in that, you know, that whole Hasbro Kenner family that we like to discuss a lot. Just Jeff says, we used our friendship as betrayal.
Damn it, man.
We are legitimately abusing the secret word. That's not what...
You've given them too much power.
But he starts with something like that. People know, like, all they got to do is just poke me a little, and I'm going to read that shit. I'm going to read it. Damn it. You guys are abusing this. I don't like it. Battle Rifle says the hydrofoil is both.
Yeah.
I think it's interesting that a lot of people, you know, they appreciate the large vehicles as playsets, right? Whale, Rolling Thunder, General, the hydrofoil, Thunderclap, like. I guess I was thinking more in basic terms of like play set, battlefield accessory, things like that. Like Dolly Fort.
Dolly Fort. I think the other thing is you have to consider is what everybody, not everybody could have those higher end, the actual play set. So for a lot of people, the APC could have became their play set. That was their bigger Joe vehicle. So I think it varies a lot by individual.
Okay. Did you find it, Mike?
Yeah, I'm just trying to find a decent picture of it.
No rush. Not a big deal. Masterson says, please don't do this to me. Okay. All right, we're good. I'm guessing a place that has to be a certain size, has to be big enough to have things around it to interact. I don't know of any small play sets. What is the ammo dump or checkpoint in G.I. Joe? So those are the battlefield accessories. Mm-hmm. Would you consider Checkpoint Alpha to be a play set?
Yes.
Yes, for sure.
I do too.
And a surveillance port as well. Watchtower, because they can be stored in it, not just interact around it.
Okay. Well, and then you have things like on the watchtower. So you have the mounted machine gun. You have the spotlight, you know, things like that. You can open the door, put figures in, take them out. Yeah, it's a mini playset, sure, you know, but it's still a playset. All those Hoth playsets that came out, some of them are only this big, but they're still playsets, you know.
Yeah. You're the Droid Factory. I mean, that's pretty little, but
that's a straight playset. Yeah. A
badass playset.
Yeah. There you go. Logic Blaster. 1970s G.I. Joe Adventure Team mobile support vehicle was definitely both a vehicle and a playset.
Yep.
That's a good one, too. Yeah.
I'll give you that. Mython says, Rolling Thunder and Killer Whale are representing vehicles, though, with no real-world locations in them other than mother bitch.
It was a hot streak for you, Jen. It was a hot streak for you.
You know how many comments I'm going to get on this from Replay Squad over the next like month saying like, that scream gets annoying. The scream gets annoying. Of course it's annoying.
Damn your eyes. I think we need a shirt or like a patch with his face on it and says that word and just says terror. Just, yeah.
It just says Dolly. Dolly. All right, let's see this thing, Michael. There it is.
There it be.
Is that, do you feel like that's a representation of a Star Destroyer?
With a kid's imagination, you betcha. As adult collectors, no.
So it has Vader's chamber, right? It does have the little pits down on the side. But compared to, say, the 79 Death Star, this thing's a little bit of a letdown.
Well, I mean, it's very small. You know what I mean? Like, it's very, very small. It's a lot of areas in one small location, so it's hard to...
This is that one toy you get to take to church.
It's still fairly large. It's about 14 inches. That's what she said. But, you know.
Good God.
It's just kind of part of a playset. You know, it's got the doors that go nowhere. It's got the little chute under the bottom that you see there. It goes nowhere. I don't know. Have any of you guys ever played with this, or was this just me? Just me? Just
the old guy? Yeah. I'd heard about it.
Good luck! Okay. Whatever.
Ewok Village, yes. This, no.
Ewok Village is a straight-up playset, yeah. And they totally... They took a good idea and they made it even better with the Prince of Thieves, where they gave it the canopies turtle on the trees. It wasn't like the whole forest got chopped up. But that's one thing I always appreciated about Star Wars playsets. They never really had bottoms, if you notice that. They just kind of had like walls or feet, and then it just sort of stopped.
Yeah.
I did really appreciate that. This is a good point. We were actually talking about this with Scuba Pete. Mikey Pally Toy puts out playsets, the vac molded playsets. Yeah, I wish they were in the US. They look pretty nice. Yeah, they're awesome, and you can get them. You're just, you know, you're going to pay the freight. That's all there is to it.
Yeah.
Getting ready to drop a turtle sewer lair. Yeah. So Ramen's doing Musk, and then somebody else is doing a legit.
Well, yeah, NECA's putting out their stuff.
But that's like...
Not a fan of turtles.
He's just like, quit. No, I see it says device not connected. Something happened to him. But that's like $500, right? And it's just almost like a little shoebox style.
I think it's...
Yeah, you're in a section, I think.
Yeah, it's for like a floor base, I think a wall, and then like half of another wall.
Yeah.
No, sir. Masterson points out Playmobil produced several playsets. Ghostbuster Firehouse, right, which we talked about, bank robbery playsets, etc. True. Very true. Playmobil's putting out a bunch. Spin Master's putting out playsets. Then you have the Chat May stuff or the Kids Connection, like the video I did with the Vertical Cobra Missile Command headquarters for $20. And then on top of that, you have so Buzz Lightyear, remember they put out those fighters, they put out the XL1 and they put out the XL15, and then they put out like that kind of Starship Troopers looking drop ship thing.
Yeah.
Did you guys ever see the playset?
It was at Target very briefly out here. Very briefly.
Like maybe I don't remember that.
Look at the size of this thing.
For like a week.
Yeah.
You are at Target more than me.
Yeah.
This thing is gigantic. $45 on Amazon for anybody in the chat who's hanging out who wants a new playset. You want to talk about features. This thing's got mad features, and it has a launch base for the XL-15 fighter, so if you've got one, you can set it inside of it. The fighter sets like that on that base, and then you can put it inside the center of the, sorry, inside the center of the playset. It's got lights, it's got sounds. This thing's pretty rad. Cool. For $45, and this is Mattel. This box has easily got to be like 15 pounds. So I guess that leads to the question. So we all have, you know, great memories of play sets. And, oh, look, they do this and blah, blah, blah. They got trapdoors and jails, right? Every good play set should have a jail. Why can't we get play sets now other than these fringe play sets that have to be customized or things like that? I know, like, NECA's putting out a turtle lair and Ramen's trying to pick up slack with stuff too, but why is it that we're only seeing them from like Playmobil or Playmates or Mattel? What's the last Star Wars playset? Is that the Tantive V4 hallway?
Yeah, that or the Jabba's lair, Jabba's throne, I think they put out.
That's right. And then they had the
staircase wasn't too long ago.
Yeah.
Which is just a staircase, right?
A staircase to nowhere.
Yeah, platform and a staircase, yeah.
Yeah.
But are they more like glorified dioramas than actual playsets?
See, I would call those dioramas, yeah, for sure. So, especially that Tantive V4 or Rebel Blockade Runner, whatever you want to call it. The hallway, that's literally a diorama. It's to me, that's even less than the Joy Toy Mech Depots, because those have four sides. And they're, you know, modular. You can take them apart, put them back together. I don't know.
Well, you got to think, I mean, the company that we're talking about that's not putting any play sets out is almost all but abandoned the 1/18th scale as it is. I mean, they've got Star Wars, which they're putting out basically just dioramas, which at this point I feel like is the bare minimum of anything. I mean, all their other brands are all, you know, they're like, hey, you got a Vamp. Be happy you got something more than just a figure now.
Right. And, you know, I don't want to say to be fair,
yeah,
but even going back to the 90s, they would put out, you know, the Death Star Escape, and it's just a hallway with a door. Or then they would put out the Endor Bunker. That's just the facade of the bunker. How many times have they put out that Endor Bunker? They even redid it as Red Shadows for San Diego Comic-Con for G.I. Joe, right? Which is really not Joe, but.
But isn't that just, again, a sign of how they're moving further and further away from, you know, gearing these things towards children? Because if they're not going to sell figures towards children, they don't need things you can play with. They need something you can set on a shelf that looks cool.
Which is very interesting, because Lego put out the Stark Tower and even the Iron Man Hall of Armor, and they all had, like, interactive things, right? Like, they had, like, a little Lego launcher. Heck, we were talking about it, I guess it was a couple months ago. We looked at some for my niece. Barbie still puts out play sets and things that are still interactive, right? They still put out their mobile camper. They still put out, you know, like a even high school set, locker room set. There's still toy lines that are still doing things, but for some reason, the main, you know, boys' toys, if you want to, they're not implementing the scenes from those particular shows or movies. It's like, okay, growing up, you saw when, you know, Shredder infiltrated the Turtles' lair, or, you know, when Tommy infiltrated even the command center for the Power Rangers. Like, that was a big deal.
Yep.
You would see these things. So these action moments took place. So there had to be some type of interaction. And there's not. There's not a lot of, okay, hey, you could set this figure here. It launches a blaster. Or, hey, let's gear up the, you know, the van and head out. No one's doing that anymore because I think we're not even allowing kids to watch cartoons or commercials and see it. It's like, oh, hey, yeah, that looks fun. That looks cool. I mean, commercials and all those layers were always the best, right? Like any cartoon you saw, wherever they gathered or whatever they were using, it's like, oh, that would be like the coolest thing ever. I remember the cartoon SWAT Cats, and me and my cousin tried to build like the garage for where, you know, they were working on their trucks. And then we went and got a styrofoam, you know, F-15 and used that as a SWAT Cat vehicle. So,
but I think what you're just saying, we don't have commercials anymore.
Yeah.
So there's nothing to like use to sell, to advertise anymore.
What do you guys think about this? Barbie still does playsets.
Yeah.
Oh yeah.
So we know that
playset. I mean, they put I think a new big one out every other year or something.
Yeah. And you know, mm-hmm. everybody in the chat keeps saying the same thing over and over and over. Yeah. Playmobil, right? We understand Pally Toy, Lego, of course. Somebody said the thing about the Walmart, which is the Kids Connect by Chat May, which I already talked on that. So there are companies that are making playsets. We know that Mattel, I'm going to argue that Mattel has not stopped making playsets, either for Barbie,
right?
Hot Wheels, right? They still make kind of playsets for Hot Wheels.
Oh, yeah.
Got locations and mountains and, you know, space launch complexes for their racetracks and things like that. That's very Hot Wheel-esque. Masters of the Universe and that freaking Buzz Lightyear playset. And you got to admit, at least they swung for the bleachers with Lightyear because the movie didn't do well at all. But those toys are freaking great. You can fit a classified figure in that fighter. You can fit 2 4-inch Joes in that figure. Awesome fighters. That base is fantastic for $45. Castle Grayskull was on shelves. You got Snake Mountain, Eternia. So they just did what the Matic Collection crowdfund pre-order. Actually, it's both. I don't know about that argument. Is a crowdfund a pre-order? I don't think so.
So the Batman playset, like normally there's like they'll do a Batman playset or like his Hall of Armor or something.
Yeah, Mattel put out Batmobile like before they lost the DC license. I feel like they would do a good amount of Batman playsets.
Kenner used to do a ton of Batman stuff. Yeah. Kenner did tons of Batman.
Oh yeah, that's another thing. White Vegeta said that. I totally forgot. WWE puts out playsets too. Like they'll put out the wrestling ring. I remember they put out the Hell in the Cell. That was a huge playset because you got to open up the cell and throw people off.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, Mattel does Jurassic Park World.
Is that Mattel?
I believe so, right? Mattel still does them.
I don't know.
That's not Hasbro?
I don't think so.
I thought it was Hasbro.
Let me look.
Sure. I don't know. I have a Jurassic World vehicle right over here. I guess I could reach for it, but you're looking. That's fine. I'm sure somebody in the chat Mattel. Already said it eight times. Mattel. Is it Mattel?
Yep.
Okay. Yeah. Need to turn that McDonald's into a Red Rocket Diner from what was the episode? Masterson. There it is. Yeah, the episode's Rocket's Red Glare.
Yep, with Roblox grandparents.
Yeah.
Yeah, and then there you go. Somewhat latest Jurassic stuff had a base pen tower. It's true. I almost did it. You see James Lucas's comment? Look, I'm not going to read it because I proofread it. Not going to do it. Yeah. Outlaw was the closest Venom had to a base. What is a play? Was it a playset? Are you guys familiar with Mask?
I'm not super familiar with Mask.
No. The Outlaw, the big semi, and it opens up.
Yeah.
Would you say that's a base or a playset?
I mean, it did open up and have features, and it was used for. I mean, it's like the same with Optimus Prime in his trailer, right? Like,
Yeah.
It's a mobile command center base, but you can open it up and yeah.
Especially when it was still Diaclone and they had little dudes, right? Because you had that little command module thingy in there that you could put a Diaclone figure in.
Yeah.
Yeah. I would accept that. Yeah. Sure. We'll say that Outlaw was a mobile playset. I'll go with that. White Vegeta, what's up? Plus, there's the Brooders. Oh, yeah. That's right. I don't want to go get it. But, yes, that's true. You can move the sail barge, but its size is prohibitive. That's what she said. So, but is it mobile, though, is the question. Like, you can move a flag.
Yeah. I would say those are the same category.
Yeah.
One probably doesn't require the same amount of help.
No.
See, there's a really good comment from Mython the Python, but I don't want to read it because that freaking word's in there.
Yeah. It's very good.
Palisades Muppets had amazing playsets. Muppets. Did it have the box with Statler and Waldorf?
Oh, if that's, it does, he's going to have to buy one.
Robert's Infinite Realm says, the Star Destroyer was awful. Yeah, it was.
I'm even Super thinking
says, of, you don't like the hole to nowhere. No,
no. I'm thinking even, you know, like Waterworld had play sets, just various, you know, other movies and we're actually looking at the Stargate action figures because I love the movie Stargate and those action figures back in the day were super, super fantastic. But they had play sets.
The Tan Awestriker.
Yeah. I'm like, you know, they still had things that were able to have a playset, even though it didn't have a whole lot of lore compared to, you know, G.I. Joe and Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles and things of that. I don't know where they stopped doing playsets and stopped them from being, commercialized. Because that's a big thing, too. I remember growing up, it's like, hey, here's the new whatever playset or, you know, someone's break. I mean, just the explosions of, oh, hey, they're standing on top of, you know, rock. You've got to get in the command post and shoot them down. Like those commercials were very, very nostalgic.
Agreed. Yeah. And that was always kind of the hierarchy of toy acquisition, right? It was figures, vehicles, playsets, figures, vehicles, playsets, figures, vehicles, and always.
Like,
you got figures and then, you know, a birthday or a holiday comes around and you're trying to get vehicles and maybe that one playset, you know, and all the lines knew it. You know, when MOTU first came out in 1981, they're like, boom, Castle Grayskull. There it is. Because everything revolves around Castle Grayskull. It's the seat of power. It's important to have that, you know. Star Wars. A lot of Star Wars takes place on the Death Star. And that was that first really awesome, three or four tier, depending on how you count, actually, with verticality. You know, and then you got the trash compactor and all that stuff. And we just saw like that whole playset technology evolve and evolve and evolve. Do you guys think that, this is for everyone in the chat as well. And I want to say hi to Kiwi real quick. Do you guys think that Kiwi? Why are we only seeing playsets from some lines? I guess I'll put it like that because you can't say playsets don't exist anymore. They do. They definitely do. But
to me, that is where a line truly says that they're geared towards kids buying their product. Because really who we're talking about not making playsets is Hasbro's big three. Their Star Wars Black Series, their Marvel Legends, and their G.I. Joe Classified. Yep. Those are the three lines that do not make playsets. Even if you consider, you know, the vintage series, if you consider the dioramas as playsets, Black Series doesn't have it. Legends don't have it.
No.
Classified doesn't have it. There's the three brands that's how they've told me that they're not selling to kids, they're selling to adult collectors.
Yep.
I think the size, the price point, and the availability also speaks to that as well, right? When you have a line that's like 60 to 65% exclusives to one degree or another, The prices keep going out, so we know that like kids are priced out of this stuff, unless their parents take them to Ross or Ollie's or whatever, and then you're still not going to get playsets or vehicles for two-thirds of those lines. And that's why I personally always argue that G.I. Joe Classified is square pegs in a round hole, right? Like, it's a military line that was always, it was always intrinsically tied to vehicles and locations and playsets and battles. And then you only do dollies because the strength of your six-inch lines revolves around superpowers and spandex. And vehicles failed with Star Wars. So if vehicles fail with Star Wars, there's no way they're going to make it with G.I. Joe. But they are, which is, I think, head-scratching, but also really cool at the same time. Even though I'm not a classified person, I still think it's cool that G.I. Joe bucked the trend that Star Wars couldn't make happen. Right? Because they came out with that First Order TIE Fighter. That freaking box was gigantic. Yep. And that thing didn't sell. Luke's land speeder, a couple other things, like Ray's little electric razor scooter thing, and it, just a couple, right? And they didn't really go anywhere.
I remember when the first set of Lego Star Wars came out, right? You had Ben, Luke, and the Land Speeder. Yeah, absolutely. I remember when that first set of Legos came out, it was like, okay, we've got the Land Speeder, and then like they just the X-Wing, the Snow Speeder. A lot of the playsets that you get is from your Lego line. Like a lot of the playsets you get are your Legos. I mean, the pick any Batman, Spider-Man, Iron Man, whatever, they have the abilities. Again, they launch missiles, they launch whatever, but you can build on them. They have commercials, they have them, you know, even in the Lego video games, you can go to that set. But most vehicles, even in Star Wars, that kind of was your playset because it took place on, you know, the Star Destroyer. It took place in the Millennium Falcon. You had a lot of these things happening, so now they can go, hey, yeah, we can make this. We can make all these vehicles, and they're smaller. You can build them and do whatever. But I think you're right. Once they start hitting that price range of six-inch figures, okay, let's do – I mean, how long have we talked about the Blackbird for X-Men?
Yeah.
Like, everyone – I mean, it's the Blackbird. It's one of the most iconic vehicles, but it also could be considered a playset. And everyone said it. Hey, even if you gave me, like, the middle of the cockpit as a playset – we take it, and they still wouldn't do it. So now when you have the new X-Men 97, that small Blackbird, people are like, oh, yeah, I got to get that. It launches missiles. But there's still no Xavier Mansion.
Could you imagine that?
Yeah.
That'd be – well, it would have to explode, though, right?
Yeah. Yeah. And I bring you over with an X-Wing, you can do it for us.
Samantha, what?
Well, and I have a question. I was thinking about, you know, the comment. So, of course, I'm more familiar with like Barbies and things that were geared towards the, you know, the pink aisle, right?
Still applies. It still applies, right? Playsets.
Yep. You have Barbie, all of the furniture, all of the vehicles, all of the playsets, everything was in scale with your Barbie house, right? If you could get to that dream house level, right? Yep. Everything fits there.
Yeah.
Pool party. Why is that working in a larger scale? Like, is it because we're not doing the 3.75 inch anymore world building stuff? So you can't really do play sets that are that large for your 6 and 7 inch figures?
Good question. Let me answer your question with a question. But first, the Foos King thought that the Star Destroyer was a coffee maker, and I don't blame you for it. Do you guys, to include everybody in the chat, right? This is a question for everyone. Do you think that if they did crowdfunding, right? But that's the world we live in, and it's intentional. Mm-hmm. Anyone who doesn't realize that this move to go to 6-inch was intentional because, like, you negate playsets and you negate vehicles unless you charge out the ass and mostly crowdfund. Intentional, 100%. And we saw, like we discussed, they've been going away from playsets at Hasbro, right? We're only talking about Hasbro because they're the only culprit.
Yep.
for a long time, they've been going away from playsets. You know, somebody in that boardroom was like, if all of our lines go 6-inch, then no one's going to ask for playsets. Done. That being said, do you think that if they crowdfunded a classified scale 83 G.I. Joe headquarters, do you think it would fund?
Oh, yeah. There are some people who would buy three of them just for the sake of buying them. And they would go, oh, it's just like what I've always wanted, even though the entire landscape.
It's what you always wanted because it's right in front of you. Like, no one was screaming for Caramel Crunch Snake Eyes until it was right in front of them. And then that completionist mentality, right?
Mm-hmm.
The collector psychology was like, well, now I got to fucking buy it because it's in front of me. I have to buy it. And I'm not saying there's anything wrong with that. But Vache, you bring up a good point. How many times have all of us seen people in toy groups or on social media posts anywhere say, if you guys don't back it, they'll never make more. And you guys should back five just so we get all the unlocks, which the unlocks are already, they're already worked into the price, right? They already admitted that. And then, you know, back out on all of them but one or two, right? We've all mm-hmm. seen that. I don't know. Mikey, do you think it would fund?
I think there would be a lot of factors if it were to fund. I mean, if it were to the same scale as the original one was to 3¾ figures, I mean, it would have to be that. You couldn't compromise on the scale of it. Mm-hmm. But that would be a massive box that thing came in. I couldn't imagine the
well, but remember, it's modular, right? So it all lays on top of itself.
Yeah. Still, though, I mean, that's a lot of layers, and how they pack stuff now is far different than how they used to pack things.
That's true. Yeah, it's that main facade piece where the cannon fits. That's going to be your tallest part. Here's another question. Well, okay, Vargo, what do you think? Do you think it would?
I think it funds as long as it's not. I mean, the cat slayer funded, so
okay.
I think if it was priced around there or under, I think it's funding. Anything more than that, I think people would really
okay. Elephant in the room, we're talking about play sets and vehicles that are play sets, etc., etc. What went wrong with the Super 7 mothership? That's a vehicle that no one had ever seen before. At least I'll give them credit, they came out of the gate like, no one's ever made this, we're gonna make it. Why didn't that fund?
I think Super 7's has, when you talk about Super 7, you have to consider Super 7's got its own issues in the background that people are aware of. You know, I think if Hasbro would have crowdfunded that, I think it would have funded in a heartbeat. I think Super 7, their O-ring stuff, they hadn't put anything else out yet. People are still a little bit, some of the Joe quality stuff, is hit or miss. I think it was, okay, that's a lot of money. That's a big ask for the first thing that you're doing.
Okay. I agree with that.
I would say one of the things that I realized was who they were targeting. Were they clearly they weren't targeting kids. They were targeting adult collectors. Mm-hmm. The average adult collector who is a G.I. Joe fan knows that was just seen in the cartoon briefly.
Exploding. So, yeah, all the time. Yeah.
So there's no way that you could really use that as the aesthetic of, okay, it's a playset, because at the end of the day, we never saw any like application of it other than what, maybe 22 seconds of the intro to the G.I. Joe cartoon.
Yeah, it was in one episode and it was like grounded in the trees. But yeah, I get what you're saying.
But so I don't think that was a good enough. It wasn't enticeable for a lot of people. You know, like at the end of the day, people didn't want it because one, it looked big and looked awkward. And I don't know what I would use it for because we never saw the inside of it. We never actually got a chance to imagine what it would be like to use the Cobra Mothership.
It wasn't important to the line of the story. Like, it wasn't like the G.I. Joe headquarters where it was in every episode.
Yeah, it was just the antagonist vehicle in the intro, really.
Yeah,
you know, and then they all come out of the fire. Again, I will always quote one of the best comments I ever got on the video I did on that, where it was Super 7 quality or reaction quality at HasLab prices. That's one.
Yep.
And then I think the $100 flat shipping was kind of a ripoff because they could ship 1,000 of them to just California. And then, you know, they're making money on the shipping because the flat shipping for $100 is a lot. That's a lot. I got to get to a couple super chats real quick. Jeremy Jernigan, good to see you. Ghost Daddy sends a $2 super chat. Says,
Jeremy,
help you freaking nerds. Good to see you, brother. Jeremy Jernigan sends another super chat. Thanks, my friend. For $5 and says, I always wanted Kenner to do a Home Alone line with a McAllister House plant set that was full of traps.
I think the line Kenner would have done.
I mean, that sounds fun, you know, just like a house. Maybe it opens up like dollhouse style and you got little traps. Honestly, I think that would sell. Lots of play features. I'm not going to use the T word, but lots of play features in there. Mm. And then Mython the Python sends a $2 super chat and says, do it, Doug. Read that really good comment. No.
You ruined it.
No, you
ruined it.
Yeah, you ruined it. You ruined it with the T word and I caught it. Mm-hmm. No, thank you for the super chat, but no.
Even just sit there and think about what you've done.
Yeah, thank you guys very much. And apparently Diffuse King doesn't like being friends with me anymore, right? Because we all have to agree on the internet, right? It's all about consensus. The Technodrome is better than the Death Star. I think a lot of that would honestly boil down to attachment. Like I have a serious emotional attachment to the 79 Death Star. Hands down, no argument there. Yeah. That's why I bought another one. And I'm sure some people have that kind of emotional attachment to the Technodrome. The Technodrome is cool because it does connect to the old sewer layer playset, and that was smart. But I'm going to disagree with you. So there.
Well, I don't know if he's saying that it's better than the Death Star. I think he said it worked. You can use the Technodrome as a Death Star, and it works that way.
Was a better Death Star.
I thought he said a better Death Star.
Was a better Death Star, yeah.
Yeah.
Mm, not better than, but functionally better. Death Star. Better.
Yeah. No, I read it accurately. Okay. I still don't agree. Matt Noon, I think the click and play base is fairly recent.
Well, they've been putting out
quite
a few years now.
Yeah they have like a dinosaur one, they have a firehouse one, they have an army one, they have the one that I turned into the missile command. There's tons of them. Just go down that weird cheapo aisle in Walmart and you'll find a ton of them. Really customizable, really easy to work with. They just got a couple screws holding them together. Really rad. Yeah. Kiwi says, I'm also making a G.I. Joe headquarters out of a milk crate. That'd be cool. Shane says, Chad, you know you got that Buzz playset for your classified Joes. No. 100% no. Forum Icebreaker, that would make a great Star Brigade playset.
We've talked a little bit about
Michael
that.
And I were discussing what I'm going to do with it. So,
does that mean you're going to get the Lunatrix Empire?
I'm not going to get the Lunartix. No.
Where are you going to put it?
In this room somewhere. Somewhere. I don't know. I have no idea.
Anybody else would have gotten a Clark Griswold comment there. It's just so we're aware.
Maybe. HG, bend over and I'll show you.
Yeah.
You got a lot of nerve talking to me like that, Griswold. I wasn't talking to you. HGC says, Lightyear movie toys are the greatest gift to customizers in the past few years. I agree wholeheartedly. Yep. Let me ask you guys this. So you all agreed on the 83, if they did a classified scale 83 headquarters as a HasLab, and so many parts of that just hurt me to say. What if for some reason tomorrow a HasLab went up for a 118 scale Cobra Silent Temple? Silent Castle, whatever you want to call it. Freaking Cobra Castle. Yes, no?
I would back it, but as long as it's not, I mean, it's gotta be priced somewhat reasonable. I'm not paying $700 for a 118 scale playset.
Reasonable.
Yeah.
I think you would have to. Regardless. Yeah, I'll say a lot of people would buy it regardless. I could see if they did a commercial and brought it out as a nostalgic piece, I think you'd get a lot more people backing it. Because now we have people putting out stuff with no commercials and no story behind them. So it's like, all right, here's this, but there's nothing to buy into it. So now, if they were to do that, they would definitely get a much better crowdfund if they did that.
Yeah, I think it would sell, but I would not buy it no matter what. I don't do playsets. But I think that would fund. Yeah, for sure.
If Hasbro really wanted to be just like, hey, let's stick it to the fans, they could go, hey, in the end of the year, we're going to do a half a dio of the Terradrome and watch half of the G.I. Joe community like have a civil war. Because a lot of people are like, well, we have the original Terradrome. You can buy customized parts for it and have your own complete set. But some people go, oh, well, they're not for 6-inch classified, so we got to get this. You know, what was it, the Tantum IV hallway? There'd be people who would buy the Terradrome diorama just because it's classified for 6-inch, even though there's nothing else with it.
True.
I think at the end of the day, Hasbro can do whatever they want. They're a big enough company to do it. It's just they're just not going to do it. They don't care enough to do it.
Yeah.
It's, hey, we're going to stay as safe as we can. And
sure, and safe is fine, yeah. Right? Because what we see going on a lot with, I don't want to just say business because I'm not like a business person, but you see it with entertainment, you see it with toys, you see it all over the place, like safe, like we're gonna rehash it, we're gonna make a sequel, we're gonna make a requel, we're just gonna do the same thing over again. But let me ask you this, Vargo. They want to play it safe, but is it working for them?
I mean, they lost me.
But look at their last two quarters in sales. Is it working for them?
I would say no. I mean, people are falling off. I've fallen off. I sold off my stuff.
And you were a 6-inch collector. You still are.
Yeah, right? I mean, I've still got Valiverse, but you know, it just. The safeness of it all just doesn't, it's not interesting to me.
But Hasbro is also not having trouble making sales of classified stuff. They're not kept on the shelf. The stuff that you see at Ollie's, Hasbro already sold that to a retailer. The retailer.
That's not a money making.
Hasbro's having no trouble selling what they want, even if
that's a Connex sat somewhere in somebody's yard, and they're like, "Oh man, we got all these toys, and those SKUs are already gone. Send them off." Yeah. Like that's a distribution thing, and we talked that to them. Yeah, and I'm not saying they don't make money. I wouldn't say that, but no one can argue that they're bleeding money, because they are bleeding money. Like they're bleeding employees.
You can point a pretty good finger at Disney why Hasbro's bleeding money.
Yeah.
Agreed.
I don't think G.I. Joe's their problem. They'll probably kill G.I. Joe because of it. But
then again, so does that point not bring up the argument? If you could make an 83 style headquarters in the 112 scale, why don't you? If you could make a Sunbow accurate 3-story headquarters for 118 scale and crowdfund it, where you have like literally nothing up front except for like the design, why wouldn't you? Like, why wouldn't you lean into the stuff that's pretty much saving your ass?
effort.
I'll say it's accountability too.
Yeah.
Do you have people that are working on the brands that really care that much about it? I mean,
there's probably a handful of people that are interested in G.I. Joe in the company, and they probably don't work on the G.I. Joe.
And business. You know, it's not the higher ups, because historically the higher ups have always had issue with G.I. Joe. And anyone who wants to argue that, I will show you proof going back to 1974. That
go
being
to
said,
DFW and talk to all the guys there. They'll tell you.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah.
That being perfect said, opportunity. Look, I always get called, the hater or the this, or all I do is dunk on Hasbro, which is totally bullshit. I couldn't say that they don't have people on the brand that love the brand. I couldn't say that. I have opinions based on observations, but I cannot say those people don't like G.I. Joe. I can't say it. I can't say that weird little dude who looks like Bud Bundy. He kind of reminds me of that Steve Buscemi, hey, fellow G.I. Joe fans, I'm a G.I. Joe fan too. But
it's again, almost like, do they like it because it's their job and it's what's giving them their paycheck? Or do they truly love the brand for what the brand has historically stood for?
Well, we know one of them doesn't, but that's not their fault, right?
I would argue that Hasbro has eliminated a third of its workforce in the last year to year and a half, right? So
to include my package art designer buddy in California, they just canned him. So
you're getting rid of anyone who probably is passionate, because they're probably the one speaking up about it saying, why aren't we doing this? What if we tried this, right? So you're getting rid of those people so that you just want the people who'll toe the line. So I'm going to say,
historically, who's that example that you just brought up?
I mean, Bobby, of course.
Yeah.
But I'm just saying, likely, no, you've got the people that are at this point terrified to hold and want to hold on to their job. So they're going to work on whatever they're told to work on.
Yeah.
I mean, I don't know anybody personally, but I'm just saying, from a business standpoint, that would make sense.
Well, I mean, I know several people personally who, I guess at this point it's all past tense, who did work there. Yeah, I mean, whatever, it is what it is. I had a really nice conversation with Corey at Joe Fest last year, right? Because remember, Mikey, that was right after he got let go. And remember when you and I were standing there in the foyer of the Marriott, and there were all those people around Corey? Remember, and I said to you, he's like the rock star this year because he just got fired.
Yeah.
And I remember talking to him one-on-one on the show floor, and I don't like to speak for people, so I don't really want to restate what he said. I'm not a fan of talking for others, but you could see it's a dream job, but at the same time, it kind of seems like once you get that dream job, maybe it wasn't.
Well,
just an observation.
Idea of the job.
Yeah, what I've heard before is you're working for Hasbro, but you're working for Hasbro.
Exactly. Yeah. Nikotronis says cost and greed is what keeps them from happening from Hasbro. Cost I get. But if you crowdfund these things and they work, that's a lot of money. I'm just saying.
I'm not
trying to make this a dunk on. I'm trying to make it hey, you could make some bank off this,
But they almost have to crowdfund at this point, because you're figuring that with all of the IPs that they're having to pay for, right? They're going to put budget towards that because they want to make up what they're having to pay out.
Yeah.
Right?
And
with G.I. Joe, they don't have to pay anything for it. So it's probably got the least budget. So they're going to have to crowdfund anything they do.
I always jokingly said that somewhere behind the scenes, they're like a fucking Ponzi scheme where the profits from Joe paid for starting lineup. You know what I mean? Or like something weird like that, because who authorized the money for starting lineup, or selfie series, they're robbing Peter to pay Paul somewhere. Yeah. Jesse from JLS Comics. What's up, brother? Good to see you. Thanks for hanging out on Wednesday night with me and Michael there. Playsets are money, so big risk. Yes. Look at the Mothership, which could be considered a playset in that field. Agreed. Yeah, 100%. But the Mothership didn't fail because it's a playset. Because again, like we discussed, Eternia funded, the freaking Cat's Lair funded. There's a lot of stuff that does fund. I think the Mothership failed for other reasons. Yeah.
Well, let me ask you guys a question.
Nope.
Do you guys remember, well, he's a teenager now, the Kid Ryan's toy review? Like his parents would buy him play sets, video game, or like toys and stuff like that, and he would review them.
Oh, yeah, that little kid?
Yeah, so yeah, now he's not like about to do it. But they would buy him a playset and he would play with it and review it and show how much he liked it. And it was cool. And he did massive numbers in sales just from him interacting with it as a kid, playing with the toy and showing what it could do and racing around with it. And to me, that was like one of the best things that ever happened, because you could see someone as a kid, genuine impression. Hey, this is what I'm playing with. This is what I'm doing. And now you don't have that. You don't have Hasbro or most toy lines pushing towards kids to actively play with these toys. We did because we saw it and we wanted to live out what we were seeing on TV or reading in reading in the comic books. So we were able to do that and go, oh, wow, I want to do this or I want to do this.
Yeah.
And we also have the ability to do that. But we're even seeing it now in video game culture. You have video games who don't put out quality work. It's like, hey, let's just do this. And everything's DLC.
Catch it after it's out. Don't worry.
Yeah, everything's DLC. So even from another medium, media is the same thing. We're not doing it for what the age group or our target audience or what we claim it to be. So it's, hey, let's just put this out there because we can, because we want the money off of it. I mean, how many great games got canceled and the directors got cut? And, you know, oh, I've been waiting for this game forever, and it never happened. Waiting for a Knights of the Old Republic remake, or, you know, still waiting for that. Nope, not going to get that. Okay, great.
Appreciate it. You know that it, I don't want to get off track because there's an awesome comment from, you know what? I'm going to put it up so I can go off the rails for a second. You know that Disney Star Wars will never touch the Old Republic in live action because they will get friggin' crucified. Right, like they'll do their High Republic shit, like they're doing with the Acolyte and all that stuff, you know, 100 years before the Phantom Menace. But they will never touch like a Revan or a Malak or anything Malgus. They will never go that far back because the entire like nerd gaming community will burn them down. Never.
But if they gave it, like Micah said, the effort, people will be appreciative of it. They would be appreciative of it. Sorry, okay. I see.
You want to give me a Starforge playset? I'll buy it. I'll freaking buy it. Let's go. George Aiken says Hasbro are reshaping playsets to be more used as a diorama, right? Which we were all discussing, right? The Tanta V4 or Rebel Blockade Runner hallway, the Stairway to Nowhere, the Jabba's whatever. Since adults display their dollies rather than play with them, agreed. That being said, is it all adults? No. I don't believe that all of us fit a certain mold, and I don't believe that because there are adult collectors who like everything. There are adult collectors who will take whatever you give them, and there are adult collectors that just like what they like.
Mm-hmm.
I'm sure there's probably others in there, but those are like the three generics, right? The ones that will take whatever you give them are the ones that will buy the Cat's Lair, the Ghost. They'll back the Mothership. You know what I mean? Because it's being offered. They're just like, boom, boom, money, money, money. Take it. I want it, right? It's stuff. I like kids' playsets. I don't want the cats. If I want the Cat's Lair, I'm going to go get the original Cat's Lair.
Yeah.
If I want Eternia. Okay. I guess I really can't say that. If I didn't have an Eternia and I was a Masters of the Universe collector, if they offered a new Eternia, would I buy it? Yes. Because you're pretty much going to pay the same price. If I didn't own a flag and Hasbro came out and said, hey, we're going to release a new flag crowdfund, would I buy one? You're damn straight. Buy one in a heartbeat. but because I want it, right? That's I like what I like. I like kids' playsets. But I don't think that all adults are like that, because I actually play with this shit and I pew, pew, pew and all that stuff. Matt Noon says, like Kirk talked about with you, Chad, just lazy or maybe afraid of failure. I think to a degree, yeah. So Kirk Bazigian and I were talking about, you know, why has the Hasbro G.I. Joe landscape changed so much? And he said that, like, he really feels that they have, like, a fear of failure, which is why they crowdfunded a Sky Striker when the F-14's been out of the Navy's inventory for how long and, you know, things like that. Yeah.
Now, Chad, to go back on George's comment there, if I may.
Please, yeah.
So Hasbro may be reshaping how they see playsets, but Dioramas was Kenner's jam long before Hasbro owned them.
Agreed.
So really, they're just going back to what they knew sold for Star Wars, which is kind of Hasbro's thing now anyway, is going back to what did work, and it just happens to be still working because you're selling to the same eight-year-olds you geared towards in 1985. You're just selling to them now as adults. Mm-hmm. Who put them on shelves and don't play with them in the dirt.
Yeah. Yeah. B-Rad Forever's here. So just want to say what's up.
So B-Rad.
White Vegeta says Black Series Snowspeeder did well, but limited quantities from what I was told. I wouldn't be surprised. I mean, it's a T-47. That's a freaking awesome vehicle all around. So. If I saw a T-47 loose, complete, boxed, whatever, and I had the money, I would buy that. I would buy that. And I'm not really a Star Wars guy, but I'd straight buy that.
The Black Series one was a really nice toy when I had it.
That's what he's talking about, yeah.
Yep.
Yeah. Yeah, I hear it's a fantastic vehicle. JLS says, I wish we'd gotten that Cobra Island playset. Oh, have you guys seen that?
Yeah.
Yeah, that would have been...
Are Samantha Vache, are you guys tracking this? The unreleased one?
No.
Okay, so during the A Real American Hero run, I can't remember the year. Jesse, give me the year, or somebody can Google it, whatever.
It's like 85, 80, 87, somewhere in there.
Yeah, I want to say it was like 87, 88 or something like that, but they designed a Cobra Island playset that opened up. And like the top kind of came down in like 1, 2, 3, and it like laid out. It was going to be this massive freaking playset. Yeah.
That would have been, I probably would have had that. Just
designs are out there. It looked amazing. And Kirk and I talked about it a little bit the last time he was on, but I would be all over that.
Be cool. Cobra needed more playsets.
Delroy, Lindo's, Wretched. Dag Nabbit. That's awesome. I would get a crowdfunded G.I. Joe headquarters only if the helipad was the roof of the jail. It is. What should be. Yeah, should be.
It is what you make.
You gotta take like the antenna off, but yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Conrad Hauser, MD, Dr. Duke the Doctor. When I think Star Wars playsets, I think of iconic locations and places in movies that are sticking in my mind. Not much Star Wars besides ships sticks out as scenes I would want to recreate with my dollies.
Hmm.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Star Killer Base. No. You could make a Taco Donna out of this and just like collapse down the whole bar or whatever.
Dad passed his X-Wing down to me and I definitely sank it, you know, at Dagobah.
Love it.
Well, that G.I. Joe, you know, the conquest of Cobra Mountain was a Star Wars playset. It was the Battle of Geonosis playset first. And then they reused it for...
There's droids on the floor.
I when I got that as a kid, I was so confused. I was like, there's a super battle droid in my G.I. Joe playset.
Molded into the floor, the backside of it. Sure is, yeah.
Oh.
I'm just trying to catch up with the chat. I want a 3¾ scale Home One.
Mm.
Could you imagine how big that ship would be? right? Return the, yeah. Everybody's tracking, right? Return the Jedi. Yeah. It's a trap, right? Home one. Yeah. Yeah. Scuba Pete's here. Love you, Scuba. I'm only 27 minutes behind on the chat. So I'm going to run through the chat. I want to know what you guys think. Moving forward, do you think playsets are just going to stay how they are? Some companies doing them, some companies not. More like fringy, lower end stuff. Or do you think the future's in 3D printing?
I think unless Hasbro makes the decision to go back and attract kids to their toys, but it'll stay the way it is. So I think there needs to be a deliberate decision by the higher ups at Hasbro and saying, okay, we need to bring kids back into this. And how are we going to do that? We're going to start running commercials, showing them playing with play sets.
Probably.
I would say they have a wide open landscape. And I say that because they've been putting out the little small Star Wars, you know, vehicles and figures that you can put them in. Growing up as a kid, we had Mighty Max, you know, you had Micro Machines. Those all were play sets, you know. No matter the scale, there was a playset and activity that you could do, whether it was a command center or as a vehicle, you had something you can do it interactively, right? Even when they made the Micro Machines, you know, the Star Wars, you open the head and it was Dagobah or it was, you know, Bespin. You, in the smallest of scales, they could do large scale as well, as Samantha's talking about with Barbie. Embargo's correct. Once they get to what they want to do for kids, I mean, the Bratz have a mobile limousine and a hot tub.
Mm-hmm.
It's Bratz. Like they had a mini cartoon. They had like a whatever. I think they had a clothing line, a movie. There's no reason with all of the IPs that Hasbro has, Mattel has, they're still making them, that you can't do something for kids. It will sell. I mean, I have a nephew who's 11 and he still likes stuff. You catered to him when he was younger. Guarantee you, I would have bought it for him because it would have been reminiscent of when I was a kid.
Yeah.
So yeah, I think that, you know, they can take a different form. I don't, you know, when we say moving forward, they don't need to be the exact same thing. I mean, mm-hmm. that you can implement technology into them. Implement your phone where your phone can control something on the playset.
Yeah.
You know, I remember, you know, the Tyco, the Battle Electronics thing that you put the VHS in and then place it interactive. Yeah. We've come so far with technology is that I think you can actually have something like that.
Yeah, even going all the way back to Captain Power or all the way forward to that freaking BB-8 where you had the app and you could go like this and he would roll. And that stuff's cool, man. Yeah, for sure. Absolutely.
Because you get them with what they're liking with video games and their phones and tablets. And you build it in to, you know, something physical.
What about this playset?
Yes.
Yeah.
I have a student that
you
I
have can, like a some kind of a plunger and explode the roof.
Yes, yeah, I could get that for her, and she would. Yeah.
Yeah.
Can it transform like the toy from Big, the transformable building?
What kid wants to play with a building?
But apparently, we.
You know what? One of the unlocks needs to be a shitload of screen doors. Meh. Yeah.
Right? Yes. I mean,
C4 and the monitor and the. Yep.
If you pre-order, you get a pack of cigarettes.
Pack of cigarettes.
Some Happy Holidays duct tape that he uses to put his Beretta on his back.
Yeah.
Teddy bear carrying cape.
You get the helicopter.
Yeah. A sweater. That hose. Says, oh, ho, ho. Yeah. Gun. A hose for sure. Yeah.
That would be rad. Jeff Butler. Hold on. Well, I already highlighted it, so
yeah, it's too late now.
Yeah, question about locations. Where do we actually keep all these playsets? Not everyone has a toy attic. Mostly just toy basements, garages, or caves. Mine are all over. I mean, there's a couple of them right there. But yeah, I got playsets everywhere. Whoa! Sorry. Where do you guys keep your playsets?
I don't buy playsets.
But I get his point. I mean, if you
have a place for those, I don't buy them.
Don't have the space, it would be difficult to have them out.
Yeah.
Okay. So yeah, a lot of people are talking about space. So I guess that's an elephant in the room that needs to be discussed. But as we see, I mean, Barbie kids, they got space, right?
Yeah.
I mean, even my daughter with all her Monster High stuff, like she's got the school and all that stuff. Even at 17 years old, she's still got that stuff displayed.
Yeah.
But if 1/12th is going to be the thing, right, the new hotness moving forward, we've got Valiverse is rolling out the Vanguard. We know that Valiverse has more vehicles coming. We know that G.I. Joe from Hasbro has more vehicles coming. Like, when do we reach the point where stuff stops coming out because people don't have the space, so they stop buying it? And is that going to limit the possibility of a classified scale 83 headquarters?
You know, I was thinking about even the question in regards to space. I mean, growing up as a kid, though, we didn't have a very big house. You know, we moved quite a bit. But my sister still had her Fisher-Price kitchen playsets, and they took up a crap ton of room, and they're, you know, 1-to-1 scale of, you know, of space, and it took up half the side of the wall. And that was, you know, in the early 90s. So I feel like people could make playsets, again, mobile command centers that you can be modular. You can stack them on a wall, you can stack them on a bookshelf or a case. So I think we could see something where someone's using technology and go, hey, here's a playset. It can be separated, put up in various forms where you have a bookshelf or underneath the shelf. Just depends on.
We had
on
space for this shit as kids, though, right?
Yeah.
If we had space for this stuff as kids, why don't we have space for it as adults? We're the adults. Make the space.
I don't
see the argument. You know, it's like, well, you know, people don't have space for playsets anymore. Fuck that. I'll be like, hey, this dining room table, it's going. It's out. Get rid of that.
I don't have guests over anyways. I don't need a dining room table.
I don't have a guest room in my house. I have a game room with a futon. If you want to stay at my house, you're on a futon in my game room. That's it. It's my house. You know, we don't park our cars in the garage because I'm in it. It's like, you know, I mean, if that's your passion, we had this shit as kids. I had a friend that had the flag, and the only thing I remember about him having the flag when we would have playtime as children is that it was always in his way and he would walk over it.
Yeah.
But he still had a flag in his bedroom.
Yeah.
But I don't.
You stay here.
I do understand that space is a thing, but as the toys get larger, what's the breaking point? Buy less stuff or stop making larger toys? Like, right. One of them is going to be the breaking point. A company wants to make toys. So if they keep making larger and larger and larger items, I mean, the Snowcat's coming, the Thunder Machine's coming. What are people going to do when this freaking classified Rattler comes out? You know, people are still going to get it, and then they'll bitch about space afterward.
Well, that's the thing, though, isn't it? I mean, we just go ahead.
I was going to say, people still buy Nerf guns, and they're like literally size of Gatling guns, and they're now people are like, oh, I got to hang them on my wall, like an actual, you know,
dude, gun rack. Our finest costuming stuff is everywhere. It's all over the place. I have like part of the Baroness's armor there. I have like Cobra Commander's hood there. I got the Viper pistol. You know, there's stuff everywhere, and I get it. Yeah, especially with costuming. That's a big ask. What were you going to say, Mikey?
I was going to say for toy manufacturers, I mean, they're going to make it regardless. You're the one that's going to have to figure out space. So if you choose to buy the, say they do an 83 headquarters, then you're the one that's going to have to find the space. You're going to buy it. They know that there's, I don't have a doubt in my mind that it would fund. So it's just going to be a matter of prioritizing displayability of a toy or functionality of a house or some sort of duality, you know, dual purpose. What do you think kind of part,
dual part purpose homestead?
Do you think part of that is an issue of these things are just offered online and people don't actually realize how big they are until they show up on their doorstep?
I do agree that spatial awareness is part of it. Like even, and again, I'm going to pick it up, right? I saw this thing on Amazon and I just saw that it was a base that accommodated that XL15. So spatial intelligence, I kind of knew the size of it because I have several XL15 fighters. But yeah, when this box showed up, I was like, Jesus, man, this thing is, that's a big box.
Yeah.
And do I have space? That's yes.
Yeah, I feel like the Rattler will be a lot of people like, oh, cool, Rattler for my 6-inch stuff. And then it'll come in a little bit, holy shit, I don't have room for this.
I'm just saying.
At least that you can hang from the ceiling.
Yeah.
Yeah, there's always that. If people want to see the true size of 1/12 scale G.I. Joe vehicles, by all means, go look at Steve's Toys. He printed a 1/12 scale Night Raven, and it took up the entire foot of his queen size bed. That's a big ass plane.
Mm-hmm.
Yep.
It would be cool to see, but no. George says, without exception, every 3¾-inch crowdfund of Star Wars has funded while 6-inch has failed.
So yep. The lightsabers.
Yeah, that Reva lightsaber was.
Which is, I don't know why they decided to do a lights. I don't know why Hasbro's decided to do lightsabers as like a main like crowdfund. When you have so many companies that make actual lightsabers and combat lightsabers. So it was doomed to fail anyway, because it's like, oh, hey, I want this lightsaber. But no one wanted that lightsaber. Like the days of getting the old school extended lightsabers are well beyond. Kids can get those anywhere. So it's like, oh, let's crowdfund this one because adults are going to want it. Are they, though? Are they really going to want that lightsaber when they go to a company and make their own? I mean, I can go online and make a really nice lightsaber for that price and be everything I want it to be.
Yeah.
And combat grade.
Fantastic light tube in it. Yeah.
Yeah. Sure.
Yep. Yep.
I just kicked my cat. Damn it.
So you're the bushwhacker?
Come here, baby. I'm sorry. Come here. Well, you know, she's the one that, she was a rescue. She was returned to the shelter twice, and she's so sweet.
Oh,
she's such a sweet baby, but she's a little finicky. She really only likes me, and she's trying to hide from my dog. So, you know, yeah. So she was right under my feet, and I kicked her. B-Rad Forever says, without a proper O-ring or modern 1/18 scale figure at retail, why would we want to buy an expensive playset? You have to have product to fuel enthusiasm. Anybody?
Same points, I guess.
Fuck it, I'll go. I've been collecting 1/18 Joe forever. So if they put out like Silent Temple or Castle Destro or something, I'd buy it. I'd 100% buy it because I'd want it.
But your nostalgia is building your enthusiasm.
See, I don't see it as nostalgia.
I would say you're already established as a collector of that scale, whereas nobody's going to open a line with a massive playset because you're assuming that your audience doesn't already have figures to support that.
So are we talking about the mothership? Or are we just talking about anything in general?
I'm never talking about the mothership. I don't give a single shit about anything cartoon related. Oh no, I'm not.
Wow.
But in this case, I will talk about the mothership. They do have figures at retail. Super 7 does have the figures that you would use to play with that. But kids don't know shit about crowdfunding. You're not targeting children if you're crowdfunding.
No little kid is gonna be surfing the net looking for this stuff, going and asking mommy daddy for that. That's adults. 100%.
Yeah, there's like 12 kids in America that looks like scroll through Kickstarter looking for stuff. Like, nobody's putting Kickstarters on their freaking Christmas list, okay? There's no Sears catalog.
All I want for Christmas is Giant Man.
Yeah. Mom, can I have this giant red phallic looking toy? Yes.
No, you can use mine.
Well, yeah, what kid's asking for anything that they're going to take 2 years to get anyways?
Yeah.
Nobody.
Well, we also have to look at durability. You know, like all of these playsets and vehicles, they made them knowing that we would take them out in the real world to establish them in a very similar setting that we would see them growing up. So it's also, you know what I mean? Like yeah, that's, yeah. This was played in the dirt.
That speaks to the longevity of Masters of the Universe specifically, right? Because Motu, yeah, they were designed to just be smashed.
I mean, Hasbro stuff is very gummy. It's not going to make it outside. If you sit outside, you know, if you sit outside in the sun for 2 hours, it's a wrap.
My rifle that looked like this now looks like this. Yeah. But then again, if I'm going to be measured, the Mobat, the Mauler, all the engine covers, compartment covers, tow cables that break if you look at them like that. And those toys were finicky.
Yeah, and so some of the Joe plastic, the vintage Joe plastic, broke very easily depending on the color. I mean,
sure.
Oh, yeah. Even some of the 90s stuff when they
same with Star Wars. Mm-hmm. Yeah, same with Star Wars, especially I'm looking at you, Vac Metalized C-3PO. Yeah, absolutely. What do you guys think about the Ghost vehicle and playset?
I would say so.
I would say that's probably more of a playset. I don't think you're going to be picking up the Ghost and swishing it very much. I think it's kind of
but again, it's designed for adult collectors, right? So.
Yeah.
If we just look at the vehicle itself, vehicle and playset, yes?
Yeah.
No? Two vehicles in one and a playset?
At a fundamental level, yes. I think the product that you're getting is probably going to end up being more of what would be a playset.
So I don't know if Bardo's still here. In Action Figure Adventure Season 2, they were interviewing a guy at, I want to say TFCon or one of those freaking locations that they always go to. And he was talking about display sets where they're not necessarily play sets. They're not necessarily vehicles. They're just like a display location. And I really appreciated the way he described that because I think a lot of these new products that we're seeing really fall under that umbrella. Like I would say the Kitana would definitely fall under display set. Because you're just displaying dollies on it. It's really all you're doing, right?
Yeah.
You're not going to play with it. It doesn't have stuff like this, you know, where features explode and, you know, walls bust out. It's just there.
Yeah.
Doors, you know, and some things open and stuff, but it's really just for display.
Yep, the big Legacy Falcon that came out that did last 2008.
That's I would definitely call that a display set.
Yeah. I mean, I was over at Retro Blastings 2 years ago, and he had it. That thing just sits in the corner. It's too big to put anywhere else.
Yeah. My favorite local toy shop, they've got one as soon as you walk in the door. It's on the left on top of a display cabinet, and every time I go in there, I look at it, but I wouldn't buy it because it's not my jam, but it's just not my thing. Brian Stevenson, we kind of already touched on this, but he was saying, is the vintage Kenner Millennium Falcon a vehicle or a playset or both? Both.
Both.
Both?
The vintage one for sure, yeah.
Bofa.
Bofa.
Bofa. Bofa D's. And then just because this made me chuckle, Balake said, "Durr, let's remake the Crow." Have you guys seen that trailer?
No, but I've
Samantha's like posts. I watched that shit.
I've seen screenshots of it. I'm like, ooh.
Samantha, what'd you think of it? Yeah. I had somebody else ask me about that the other day.
You're I was like, this is the worst punk rock thing I've ever seen.
Oh. Yeah. It was just very like a goth kid wrote a fanfic.
Yeah. Nope. There is no Crow outside of Brandon Lee, period.
No.
Yeah, I mean that's just my argument, but whatever. Catching up on the chat. Here we go. This is why I don't like being behind, because a lot of this, like, the context is gone. Is what it is. I enjoyed it. Still enjoy talking about it.
He had mentioned earlier in the chat that he had lost a lot of stuff in Katrina, and people were sending their condolences.
Yeah. You talking about this? Yeah. I had literally everything Joe put out in the 80s, lost it all in Hurricane Katrina. Man, that sucks.
Oh, dude.
I have one O-ring figure left from that time. It's all about customizing now.
Jeez.
Can't imagine.
Yeah, I'm really sorry to hear that. That actually made like, yeah. Yeah, that sucks. I'm sorry to hear that. B-Rad said, it's hard to completely love 1/12 scale because it is limited world building.
Mm-hmm.
They look great on shelves, but how often do you find yourself picking them up and fiddling with that? That's like, I like to, like, I'll pick just things up and just, you know, just move them around and just do stuff. I don't find myself doing that with 1/12 scale. With 1/18, I'll pick them up, put them in a vehicle, you know, move them around in their seats in the positions. And
yeah, I think that's just the fundamental difference between the scales, which is weird because it doesn't apply to, say, a Masters of the Universe, you know? Masters of the Universe, 5.5 inches when it started, it's whatever it is now because they just keep getting bigger and smaller and bigger and smaller. Mm-hmm. But they always had vehicles, playsets, mounts, the whole nine yards, and it just didn't really affect it. But something about a Star Wars or a Joe, you know, it just doesn't.
But do you think it's because Motu wasn't hyper articulated, hyper realistic? I mean, it's the figures move their arms and move their legs. You get what you need to do out of them.
They turn their heads, actually. Yeah. Thank you. Okay.
They're like wrestling figures. They're made to just smash around each other.
Yeah.
Yeah. They're pretty much the LJN with a little more articulation.
You feel good about yourself?
Sorry.
Are you talking to your collection?
I'm talking to my cat. She just knocked my freaking GoBots box down.
That's for kicking her.
I thought you had a small soldier at the moment where Arson was talking to the rest of the Gorgonites. And you're like, what?
So Logic Blaster says, I saw a recent interview with Daryl DePriest. Yep, he was the brand manager. And he says the current people working on Joe are fully committed to 6-inch scale.
It's selling for them right now. I mean,
yeah, I mean, it's, you know, we're just following current trends. A couple of things, though. Yeah, Daryl DePriest, totally an expert in his time. He's still, you know, one of the major names of G.I. Joe, but he doesn't work at Hasbro anymore. They're going to be committed to whatever their boss is telling them to be committed to at the end of the day.
I was going to argue, what's the commitment? Is it commitment to
the
actually
commitments to fucking product? Money? And at the end of the day, the only thing that's ever killed G.I. Joe in every single incarnation of G.I. Joe was Hasbro. Not sales. You can't say sales because 93 was a Real American Hero's second biggest year. And in 94, they were already killing it.
Before and I would say it.
Came out. So it's not money. It's just when they get tired of it, they'll kill it.
Well, so that 94 was a vendetta, a very specifically geared vendetta.
It was. Yeah.
Yeah.
When that Cobra Mountain came out, I know I was basically keeping G.I. Joe alive because I collected all of those when I was younger. Me and my little brother, Spy Troops, all of those, like everything I was trying to get my hands on that I could save up money for, we'd put away and you know.
And I'm sure the people who are in charge of the G.I. Joe brand are fully committed to 6-inch scale. I'm sure they are, but that doesn't mean shit.
My local Toys R Us growing up, they knew I was the Joe kid. So when they came in, they're like, we got the new Spy Troop stuff over here for you.
Yeah. Yep. Laser Pants. What's up, Ryan? Hasbro needs more AliExpress Nick Cannon. You guys know who he's talking about?
The kid from Holes.
The have. Kid from Holes who was like, yo, I got the self-assures. And he's like screaming to the DJ guy. And I'm like, I remember watching that. And I'm like, who the fuck do they keep yelling at? He's like, yo, man, check this shit out. I got Serpentor. Oh, it was so bad.
So you know bad. What? It created the Serpentor, though. That was worth it.
It creates Serpentor. Yeah.
Yeah.
Diet Nick Cannon. Yep. Screaming about Serpentor. But I mean, dude, if it works, it works. Like, I'm not trying to dog on anybody or anything. I just wanted to talk about playsets, you know, and how much we love playsets. There are still companies that make playsets just because, you know, again, like that video I put out, Hasbro doesn't want to make you G.I. Joe playsets, make your own.
I think it also shows the power of a playset because you made a Cobra Missile Command and then everybody goes, oh, I want that. So, again, the power of the playset, when advertised correctly, can literally make you money.
And now you have a guy on eBay selling them.
But you know what? He reached out to me, and he was actually really cool about it.
Oh, yeah.
But well, they're selling.
How far your reach goes, Chad. You know what I mean? Like, how far? But just look at it. From you making that.
It was one idea that it paid off. It was one idea that paid off. That was it.
Inspired someone.
So if Hasbro or Mattel, if everyone has just one person that's committed to making something well and going, hey, we can reach this towards children, I mean, look at what can happen. I will say Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles is a great example of every generation has their own version of Turtles.
Yeah.
And every generation does their version of the Turtle Van, which, again, for me, one of the greatest vehicles ever. They will do that rendition and kids will buy it. Kids will love it because it speaks to them. They will at least advertise Turtles, no matter how they look to us growing up. But every generation that's like, oh, hey, here's Turtles and here's something that you guys can get into. I can tell you, my boss's daughter, she's 5. She likes Ninja Turtles. She likes the PJ Masks stuff as well. So there's play sets and vehicles that when advertised based on the shows or the cartoons or the commercials, they will get bought.
Yeah. I put up this comment from 36 minutes ago. I'm sorry, just because I thought it was funny. But you do bring up a good point, Vachey. Every generation has their Turtles. Every generation has their Masters, right? You saw the Filmation Masters, the 2002 or 2000X, however you want to articulate that Masters. Then you got the Netflix Masters, you know, the Revelation Revolution. Then you got the kids stuff. You got all that turtle stuff. To me, for the sake of argument, that's because Playmates, Nickelodeon, right, and Mattel have faith in those brands.
Yeah.
Because they keep bringing them back around.
I mean, but you saw that in Joe for a while. You had the original 60s Joe. Then you had Adventure Team. Then you had Real American Hero. And then you had the early 2000s stuff that put itself to kids. And it's kind of once they got to that modern articulation stuff, they said, okay, we're done trying to get a new generation into G.I.
Yeah, Sigma 6, yeah.
So would you argue that that's kind of based on that that mentality of it's a war brand?
I think so. I think they got to a point they were just like, you know what, it's a war brand toy. We've got the people that we want buying this. We're not worried too much about bringing anybody else on this brand, because let's be honest, we just want to kill it as soon as we can anyways.
Yeah. Cause even we know the whole thing with, you know, the movable Fighting Man and Adventure Team and the pivot to everything during the whole Vietnam War thing. Right. We all know that. I'm sure everybody's seen the Nickelodeon or Netflix. I'm sure everybody's seen the toys that made us, but, even as far back as 79, when, you know, Bob Prupus and Kirk Bazigian were trying to get Steven Hassenfeld to get back on board with G.I. Joe, there were people saying like, No, it's just a war brand. No, it's just a war brand. Like, we need to do something else. Like, G.I. Joe is dead. And then again in 94, and then we saw it again in 95, yep, when even Sergeant Savage was killed before it hit shelves so they could make G.I. Joe Extreme and kind of, you know, whatever. I don't know.
Mikey, then it went to Toys R Us for a couple years, and then...
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. And then even when the modern stuff was killing it, you know, they made it a Toys R Us exclusive when they knew that Bain Capital was stealing money from Toys R Us.
So, yeah.
And I think what Mark Weber said, that Toys R Us wanted more stuff. They were like, give us more Joe. Give us more Joe. And Hasbro was like, nah.
Yep. 100%. Yeah. They were like, we can't keep it in stock. Like, we want more. And then, yeah. No.
I don't consider it a war brand. It's just a good, you know, good versus bad or good versus evil or whatever brand. I mean, you can make it what you want.
Yeah, I don't. They never considered it a war brand either. That's why they called it, like, you know, G.I. Joe is the code name for America's daring, highly trained special mission team. They were trying to, when they came up with a real American hero, they wanted to tie in all those adventure elements so it wasn't just seen as like war, and it never was. It was like a very much good versus evil, like we're teaching kids right versus wrong. It wasn't supposed to be so much, you know, us versus the Soviet Union, blah, blah, blah.
Yeah, I mean, the individual kid could make it that, but that's not how it was, you know.
Does it not have like a little PSA lesson, more you know, more at the end?
Don't hide in fridge. Don't hide in fridges.
Yeah, now I know. Yeah, and I don't think the war brand thing has really played a factor in the last couple decades. I think that was an old argument. I think they've moved on.
I think it was the 60s. It was the 60s.
Well,
probably.
Yeah.
Yes.
Parents really played a factor into what their kids bought, not just buying them something so they'll stop yelling at them.
True. But once G.I. Joe was established, that argument went away post, I want to say, like 96. That argument was long gone. However, again, pause for dramatic effect. Post 9/11, the whole Cobra part of the G.I. Joe became really touchy.
Well, yeah, the language of it changed a little bit, for sure.
Yeah,
it adapted a bit.
Even in that new game, they don't call it a ruthless terrorist organization, right? They just call it a ruthless criminal organization.
Oh, yeah, the 2002 Joe vs. Cobra, the black package stuff, originally came out stated that Cobra was a terrorist organization. Right after 9/11, reprinted those, took that off.
Yep, 100%. And that's part of the issue with the traditional sense of Cobra, is that terrorism, it's a very real thing now, right? Even though it always was real for a lot of people, you know, I think it became more real for people in Pawtucket, Rhode Island, because they're pretty close to New York City, you know?
Yeah.
I think that's when it became like a thing. Because you didn't see a lot of G.I. Joe blowing up with the whole war on terror, right? Yep. OIF and OEF, you didn't see G.I. Joe blow up from that. Even with the Gulf War, we got that Gulf War 12-inch Duke, right?
Yep, the first Hall of Fame Duke or whatever.
But after 2001, 2002, it all just...
I think that's the last one my dad collected.
Yeah.
Because he does all the 12-inch Joes.
So does Mikey's dad. Yeah. We got a $10 super chat from Mython the Python. Thank you, my friend. And says, I just want to say this is just such an awesome topic tonight with great guests. Agreed.
Thanks, buddy.
I appreciate each one of you streaming and the lovely people in the chat for all viewpoints shared. Yo, Joe for the Empire. Thanks, brother. Appreciate it very much.
I think Yo, Joe for the Empire is kind of contrasting statements there.
He's part of the 501st.
Yeah.
Python's part of the 501st. So,
I just imagine G.I. Joe fighting, you know, the Empire now.
I'm surprised we haven't got that crossover yet.
Mm-hmm.
Scuba Pete says, Playsets is why I'm digging Pally toy sets, like a love letter from Kenner. Yeah, Pete, we were talking about Pally toy earlier in the show. Mikey, will you drive the chat for a minute, please? Just throw some stuff up.
I don't know where you were.
Because made a promise that I was going to open two things tonight, and I got to do it now because we got to get out of here for Hella Dope. But I made a promise.
Yeah. So Matt Noon says, I will say that the toy photography world seems to take a seems to favor and look great with the 6-inch scales, but it doesn't stop me from taking pics of my 118. I think that's pretty accurate, and I think that's probably why we're seeing a lot of the diorama stuff.
Yeah,
because you're going to display stuff, and they're kind of going to just be sitting in a diorama, and that's the toy photography has gotten huge in the last like 10 years.
Yeah, and that's why guys like KB Jotographs, like Keith Bradshaw, he'll do photos of 1/12 scale, 1/6 scale, 1/18 scale. Like, it really doesn't matter. Like, Keith's just all of it. But yeah, I will agree with that. So while you're still driving the chat, I got this surprise box from James Lucas, and I'm gonna open this as we're trucking.
Red.
If I can open it.
Logic Blaster says, in the late 1990s, we saw other brands like 21st Century Toys producing World War II stuff, so the war toy stigma seemed to go away for a while. That's very true. And they were doing stuff that was retro war as well as modern stuff. Dad and I bought so much 21st Century from Toys R Us.
Yeah, absolutely. BBI Elite, so all that stuff. Even the Toys R Us brand, the True Hero Sentinel 1. What about that shirt you're wearing there, Vargo?
Yeah, the
that
core
never went away.
They've been around since 86. I mean, they've been kicking. But, you know, at 21st Century Toys, they were putting out German soldiers. They were putting out Japanese soldiers.
Yeah.
And they were selling. I mean, there was never... Yeah.
You got active.
Yeah, they always
like, we can't use Nazis anymore. It's like, yeah, I think you can. Yeah. All right. So, now that I got it open, so the inside flap says, congratulations on your retirement.
And, I didn't bring my streamers.
Huh?
I didn't bring my streamers.
Dear Chad, hey, buddy, when I heard you were retiring from the Army, I wanted to get you something to commemorate and honor your service. I knew this was something you wanted, and would definitely love. So I enlisted the aid and something of our mutual friend, the one and only Master Matt LaCroix.
Mikey?
Oh,
it's a box of D's Nuts, customized by Matt LaCroix.
D's Nuts from Stanton Matt. He knocked it out of the park. This is from both of us, and we hope you love it. I can't think of anyone who deserves their own figure.
Oh.
More than you, you are an awesome, genuine guy. Your streams and videos are wonderful and make my day. When you sent me the Megatron Hiss, it meant the world to me. You didn't know me, but you sent it because you're generous and a fellow Baroness fan. You gained a lifelong friend that day, and your friendship means a lot to me. So enjoy this, my friend. James. Oh, I'm like on the freaking spot now, dude. I told you, Mikey. I fucking told you he was going to do it. Look at this, dude. I'm sorry.
No, this is
sorry, great. Hella Dope. I'm taking too long. But, you know, this deserves it. Look at this, dude.
Oh, that is legit.
Yep.
Yes.
He said he was going to do it.
Great. Now I got to get one somehow.
Oh man, that is so rad. And look, right? Because I'm known for wearing operator's caps.
Yes.
Operator's cap and an M4 with a freaking gangster grip. That is me right there, baby. You know, it's funny, Mikey. Remember that other thing we talked about?
Yeah.
Yeah, that's the thing. Dude, James Lucas, thank you so much. You and to Santa Matt. I will send you both a wonderful, wonderful message. Thank you guys so much for that.
That'll look good with a certain MP sketch that I saw on a certain DFW.
Oh, man, I cannot wait for this show. I can't wait. Vashay, Samantha, we're going to do like a big old meet and greet, freaking hangout sort of a thing.
Yeah.
I talked to Greg about getting a room to do like a maybe a panel, but it's gonna be awesome. Okay, Mikey, what else you got? I got one more thing to grab. Man, dude.
Oh no, I got actually
Mython super chatted the actually, so you know it's meant. So actually, Embargo, the Empire brings peace and stability to the galaxy, just like G.I. Joe does on Earth. Coburn the Rebellion, our terrorist organization.
I have brought peace. Yeah, that's true.
You know what that reminds me? Did any of you guys ever watch on YouTube? It was like, this was like earlier days of YouTube. It was like the Joe Cobra, G.I. Joe Star Wars Cobra conflict. It was called the Clone Cobra conflict. It was just this like 13 part, some guy playing with toys on his backyard at Star Wars and Joe.
That's wonderful.
I mean, really, wouldn't it just be like Vader and Luke, like slaughtering everything? To me, that's like
or just Joe's just going after just hordes of stormtroopers. Just
that would be rad.
Merkin stormtroopers,
just mowing them down like battle android troopers. Like, yeah.
There's roadblocks on the deuce. Just go.
Yeah, that'd be super cool.
A-10s going through the trenches, bombing the Death Star.
Would it be content farming if I made a video of this?
No, I think it'd be great.
Yeah, I think
you should go out to the backyard and play with it in the dirt when you do it.
I think you need to bring
him. No, because the freaking prairie dogs would take it.
Don't leave it out there. Bring your sidearm. You can take care of the prairie dogs.
Prairie dog.
It's a plus 22. Nobody will hear that shit.
Thank you for the $5 super chat. All right. I got one more. This is from Jeremy Kerr. This is like a big ass box. Okay, bye.
That's nuts and bolts.
Good day, Chad. I hope this package has found you and your family well and in good health. Inside, you will find your brand new Dollymobile. With any luck, the post office did not drop kick it across the country. They did not. Feel free to roll it across the floor, making vroom, vroom, and pew, pew sounds. I will. I won't tell anyone. It will be our little secret. I will tell everyone. Please tell the ma'am I said hello and give the puppers a little pat on the head for me. Sincerely, Jeremy Kirk. Thank you, Jeremy. And
what's in the box?
Oh, well, we were just talking about this. Come here, Callie. I got to smack you on the head for somebody. Come here, baby. Yeah. Okay. I did that. I'm sorry. This is like anticlimactic. Oh,
yeah.
Weren't we just talking about this?
Yeah.
Oh, man. That is rad. That is
awesome.
So you already got a pilot for it, and you already got a driver.
Yep.
I do.
Matt sent the driver. He sent the truck.
I'm the vehicle commander, baby. I'm not a driver. I've never been a freaking driver. That
you
is
put the retro desert rat in there with you.
Oh, yeah.
Rock out with Tony.
I put the retro desert rat in my tan Austriker. But, yeah. That's thank you, Jeremy. That's really rad.
Super.
Pew, pew, pew. Yeah, I will do that all day.
Dude, that would have been crazy if that would have been the sand rail after literally just talking about it the other
night. Yeah, we were just discussing that.
That would have been crazy.
So crazy.
Is the ma'am going to cosplay every day?
At DFW?
Yeah.
No. No, we're not going to get like super heavy on it. One, most of the finest, the Texas Garrison, I've been talking to them and I can't really get a good feel on who's going to be there and who's not going to be there. I know the 501st is going to be there, so I don't know if Mython said he was going to costume with them, but we'll costume at least once. But generally when we do, it's not for the whole day. It's like a half a day, and then we get out of it because it gets really hot. So
we're gonna be in Dallas. Some shit's gonna be hot as hell.
Plus, you know, I wanna hang out, and I'm not like, hey, how's it going? You know, while I'm in this whole get up, but yeah.
And we'll Cobra officers don't wear checkered bands, so you've got to slip into those at some point.
That's right.
Functionality over fashion.
I might rock my business suit and my Cobra Commander hood. I might. I might rock that once.
You have a Cobra lapel pin?
Yeah. Oh yeah. I absolutely do.
That won't last long in June in Texas.
None of that will. No.
Helmet
and the mask, it's very like it sucks.
So you need one of those suits that has the shorts and then like Cobra socks.
Yeah. We got one more super chat, and that's from Logic Blaster for $10. Thank you, my friend. Thank you so much. Chad, thank you so much for these live chats. I absolutely love hearing honest opinions about toys and collecting. Thank you very much, Logic Blaster. And
thanks for watching.
You got one more.
I just got to call it as I see it. And thank you so very much. Look at James Lucas, $2 super chat. Dude, thank you so much. Says, so glad you like it. You deserve it. Hey, stop it. I'm sorry. Dude, James Lucas, thank you so much. You and Matt LaCroix, I thank you. That's all I can say. Now I just feel weird. I just want to go sit on the couch. Thank you guys so much for hanging out with me.
Always. Always.
Talking play sets and dollies and new vroom vrooms and all sorts of stuff. Mr. Vargo, your core video is freaking awesome.
Thanks. I'm glad a few people have enjoyed it.
Yeah.
Oh, I love it.
Yeah, that was a freaking awesome video. Anybody who's hanging out, if you haven't gone to MVARGO's channel and seen his videos on the core, please go do so. And then, of course, this guy down here, Mr. Action Figure Customizer Extraordinaire. Wait, I looked the wrong way. All right, ready? 3, 2, 1. Oh. Is it like that?
We do like the Michelangelo.
Anyway, okay. Bashay, Samantha, always a pleasure to see you. Thanks, guys, for hanging out.
Absolutely.
Yeah. I was like, what are you doing? Chilling. You want to come hang out?
Yeah.
All right. You guys are awesome. James Lucas, again, thank you so much. Jeremy Kerr, thank you. Everyone who sent a super chat, thank you so much. You never have to, but it's always humbling and appreciated. Do it again.
Yours is a square, Chad. Make a heart, damn it.
Man, I can't. I suck. You know how long I sat with my kid trying to do this?
Oh,
shit?
Flashing gang signs now? Calm down, dude.
You want to get back?
God damn. We're just throwing hearts, and you're up there
like,
throwing
what's up, kid?
Crips and fight?
Anyway, thank you guys all so much for hanging out with us and talking play sets. Please go over to Hella Dope Toys. And Samantha, you're signing us out.
No, you do it.
No, you had to. Yes.
Have an awesome day.
Yeah!